Hi, and welcome to the second Office Hours. Again, we had a lot of really good questions in the forum, so let's get started.
All right, what's the first question?
First question came from Matthew Atkinson, and he has heard that you shouldn't use functions like eval and exec, which we did use in unit 2. So he wants to know, why shouldn't we be using these functions, and what's the problem with them?
Okay, yeah, that's a great question. And there's a couple of reasons to avoid these. One is for security. Especially if you're going to be evaling a string that somebody passes into you, you don't know what it's going to be doing. And there's lots of dangerous commands that Python can execute, like delete all my files. And you don't want to be asking somebody to type something in and then go execute that and allow them to do something dangerous. So that's one reason. And then the other is just in terms of program structure, that we like to write our programs so that the functions and variables and so on have a set scope, is that this variable exists from here to here. And eval kind of breaks all that structure and goes outside of it and says, we're executing something right here, but it's not executing with respect to where we are in the code. It's executing someplace completely different. And that makes it harder to follow the code. So nothing wrong in terms of do you get the right answer, but harder to understand, and so we should minimize it. I used it in the assignment for week 2 because there was no other way to easily get around it, but you should minimize the use.
Okay, thanks. The next question comes from Sashin, and Sashin wants to know a little bit more about this big O notation that we introduced and saw a little bit of in unit 2.
Yeah. So that's the answer to that question is a whole course in algorithms, and we can't do that right here. But basically, the idea is big O says approximately how many instructions is it going to take to execute this? And actually, big O is an upper bound on that, and there's another notation less widely used with big theta, which gives a more exact bound. But the idea is if I have a doubly nested loop that says for I equals 1 to n, and then inside of that is nested for j equals 1 to n, then that's order n squared, because we're going to do n times n executions of the inner loop. And the basic idea is that's more than if we were just doing order n executions of the loop. And so if you can get away with a single loop instead of a double loop, that's better. That's really all you need to know about big O.
All right, and I should say there will be an algorithms class sometime in the near future for those of you who want to learn more about this. Thomas Grace had a question about these attributes you use, function attributes, specifically in the C function that had C.starts and C.items.
Okay.
What's going on there?
Yeah, so Dave Evans in CS101 chose not to really focus on Python classes, which is probably a good choice because it's a big topic. And the idea here is that classes of objects can have attributes. And these are parts or components of the object. And they're named with this dot notation. So object, dot, and then the name of a field that's part of the component of that object. And in most languages, you define all the fields ahead of time. When you define what a class looks like, you says these are the fields that composes this object. Python is a more dynamic language. And some classes of objects, you're allowed to add fields to them as you go. And functions are one of those types of dynamic objects where you can, at any point, you say, I want to add a new attribute to this function. Other objects have that same approach where you can add to them. And so what was going on in that C function is that I needed two variables that I wanted to keep track of something. I needed two counters. And I could have just used a global variable name. But that would be cluttering up the namespace. And there'd be no way for you to, if I just made up a name like C starts and C items, by looking at the name of the variable, you could figure out that they were related. But there'd be no structural way to say that these are all related, they belong together. And you want to minimize the number of global variables because people's memory is small. And so by putting everything into one object, we say this belongs together. And so using c.start rather than a variable name c.start is a way of structuring things together. And in Python, you can do that automatically. You don't have to have a declaration. You can just say, I want to add a new attribute to a function, and you go ahead and assign it.
Great. I had no idea you could do that either. I was very excited to see
this. So if you come from a language like Java or C, you're not used to that. There, you got to declare ahead of time what your attributes are going to be.
Right. Next question comes from Tracy Zellman, and she just wants to hear a little bit about when do we use lambdas? How do you decide when to use a normal function versus lambda?
Okay. So all a lambda is a function definition without assigning a name to it. So a normal function definition, we say def, then we say the function name, the arguments, and the body of the function. So we're simultaneously doing two things. We're defining what the function does, and we're giving it a name. Now, what a lambda does is break those out, saying we're defining a function, but we're not giving it a name. Well, why would you want to do that? Well, we do it all the time. So if we have an expression, like say we have the arithmetic expression x plus 1 times x minus 1, we didn't bother to give names to those subcomponents, the x plus 1 and the x minus 1. We just wrote them down. And so a lambda is like that. It's a function that's a small thing. We didn't want to bother giving it a name. We just wanted to use it in place. And so that's the advantage of lambda, that you aren't bothered with a name, and you can just write it right there rather than having to define it at one point and then use it at a second point. That's the good thing about it. The bad thing about it is that it's limited. In Python, lambda can only have an expression. It can't have statements in it. And it just doesn't really fit with the rest of the language. Some languages are really designed around expressions like that, and they go really well. In Python, it doesn't fit that much. So I think mostly you should avoid it, and you just define a function with its name in the normal way. But sometimes it's really convenient to put everything in one place rather than having to define in one place and use in a second place.
Great. Udacer had some questions about the program design strategy that we've been using. Namely, should we implement this strategy that we've been using in every single problem we approach, or are there somewhere we don't really need it? And if we choose not to use this strategy, what are some of the disadvantages?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, whatever you can do to get your job done, go ahead and do it. I've given you some approaches. You know, I wouldn't say that there's just one strategy, but rather there's a collection of strategies that you want to be able to understand what's going on, make your inventory of concepts, build those up. Now, you have a lot of choices within that. Do I want to start top-down, bottom-up, middle-out? That's all up to you. As long as you arrive at the end of a description of the whole domain and the whole program and you get it right, then congratulations to you. So I think everybody develops their own style for how they go about addressing this. But there are ideas of what it means to have a high-quality program, correctness, efficiency, and so on. And then more driven by taste is what does it mean to be readable and extensible, and you'll learn that over time.
Great. And for one last question, Takanzi wants to know if you have any good recommendations for computer science and specifically Python books.
Books, okay. Yes, I do have some recommendations, and if you search for Peter Norvig's library in Google Books, I have some there, and with this question, maybe I'll go and update them some more. I can mention a few. In terms of general programming books, I really like The Practice of Programming. I like The Elements of Programming Style, which is rather an old and somewhat dated book now in terms of the examples it uses, but still really up to date in terms of the advice. I like Structure and Interpretation of Computer Programs, which has been a standard textbook for introductory computer science. I like Programming Pearls is a nice collection of kind of short essays. And then in Python books, you know, there's a lot of them, and I haven't kept up with all the possibilities. There's a nice online book of How to Think Like a Computer Scientist that has a Python version. There's Python in a Nutshell, Python Cookbook, Learning Python. Head First Python, is an interesting, somewhat different approach. So there's lots of them there, and I'll try to update my Google Books library to give a little bit of commentary on each one.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for all the questions. Thank you for your answers.
Okay.
Stay tuned for the next unit, which will be posted on Sunday, and also for a couple more additions to the Python glossary.
All right. See you in class.